In this video, we are going to see an introduction of basic computer organization. Okay, so a computer model, what will be the basic thing in a computer? That's what we are going to see. Here, it will consist of input unit, output unit. Then between them lies the central processing unit, which consists of control unit and arithmetic and logic unit, which in turn they are connected to memory unit. If you see this arrow, you can understand how the flow of data from the input unit, the data is fed to the central processing unit, which is nothing but our microprocessor or computer, whatever it is you call. Then the information for the user will be sent to the output unit, okay, in order to see the output. Then, for example, if you take an input unit is nothing but keyboards, mouse. Okay, there are so many input units are there. So using all those things, you can enter the data into the computer. Right? If you are, say, for example, you are working in Turbo C++. Now you have C. Okay, so see how you will be doing. You will open the editor and then you start typing the information. Okay, the code you will type. So for that, what you use keyboard. So now using keyboard, you are entering data into the computer. Okay. So when I say computer, it is a, it is a term which will consist of all these things. But actually what you are feeding in is stored in the main memory, which is nothing but this memory unit. So whatever you enter, that will be temporarily stored in this memory unit. Then from there, the data will be fed to the, if you have arithmetic, if you write any program, you will have some calculations, then you will have some logical execution, all those things, isn't it? So those informations will be executed because memory unit will only store the data. Okay, it will not do more than that. But this arithmetic logic unit will do the process which you have asked, the instructions, whatever you enter into your compute, into your program will be executed here. And this control unit helps in that. It has clock, it has many signals which helps in fetching the data from the memory unit one by one. Because you write the program in a sequence, isn't it? After the first step, the next step, and so on. So how it will be executed? That is by these control units, and there are many registers on that. So using them, one by one, the data will be taken from the memory unit and then they will be executed. Once the executed, you will need an output. So that will be sent to this output unit. Now, what is output unit? Generally, we see it in our computer monitor. Okay, so input unit is both a input unit is a computer monitor itself is a input unit. Because through keyboard, when you type, you see the information in your monitor. So a computer monitor can be a both the input unit and the output unit. So you can see your output execution, what will be the output, everything you see in the screen. Not only that, if you want to take a printout, okay, you send the data to a printer. So there also it is a printer is an output unit. Then a pen drive. A pen drive you can insert into a computer and you can fit data into it. Okay, so in that case, it works as an input unit. As well as you are storing, after you do something, you may want to store some information back in the pen drive. In that case, it acts as an output unit. Okay, so a computer consists of, these are all the main thing. So in a broad sense, I can say it consists of an input unit, output unit, memory unit, and then control and arithmetic logic unit. Here you can see the input from data flows in only one direction. So whatever you give the data, that will be given here. Then here also output unit one direction. Whereas control unit, it has both side arrow, which means the data, well, the signals are moving from here to here, and here to here, and so on. Then memory unit, the data is in from the memory unit to the CPU, as well as the result can be stored back in memory unit. So it is a two-way operation. Now we'll see in brief the central processing. This is what we are going to see. A central processing unit consists of the following thing. What are they? Control unit and arithmetic logic unit. So what is a control unit? This unit, it controls the operation. That is why the name. It controls the operation of all parts of our computer, right? So it controls the information flow and control signals. So how the brain controls everything, it coordinates with all parts of our body. If the brain is not working properly, our input-output unit of our body, which is nothing but our legs, okay, our hand. Input, you can say our eyes. Eyes are input, isn't it? Through eyes, we see the information and we see many things and give all those informations to our brain. And then brain takes those things and process and then send information to our hand. Suppose we have dinner. Okay, we have we have some dosa in our plate. What we will do immediately? But we see that information goes into our eyes, through our eyes, and the brain process, and it gives instruction to our hand, and our hand is our now output unit. Okay, and it picks the dosa and put it in our body. In the case, now it acts as an input unit. So here, so controlling, the controlling is done by our brain. Here, we have exclusively control unit, which controls. See how brain controls all part of our body. Likewise, we have control unit, which control, it has many signals, which controls all part of the computer. So it is responsible for coordinating all the units of the computer. That's what I said. It communicates with I/O devices for transfer of data. So the control unit is responsible for transferring information to the input unit, getting information and transferring all those things. The control unit is responsible. Then we come to arithmetic and logic unit. This consists of two subsections, namely arithmetic and logic sections. So arithmetic section, this is responsible for doing all arithmetic operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, etc. And logical, taking a decision. So for example, if x is greater than 5, then what it has to do? You will be writing coding in this way in your program. So those decision making. And in for loop also, you have some decision, isn't it? For I equal to 0, I less than n. So it constantly checks. So it checks, checking and taking a decision, all those things, matching whether it is equal to or not equal to, less than. So all those things can be done. So in order to do that, we have exclusive logic sections. Some of the input and output unit are, these are some of the input devices, keyboard, mouse, joystick, light pen. When you are doing games, playing games, that game station, you are having those remote. So that is also an input device. Trackball, scanner. A scanner is an input device. Graphic tablet, microphone, magnetic ink card reader, optical character reader, barcode reader, optical mark reader. All these things, they feed information into the computer. So using all these things, we feed information into the computer. That's why they are all called input devices. Some of the output devices are printer, monitor, hard disk, floppy disk, etc. So in this picture, I have taken it from some website. This is nothing but a small model of an interconnection of components inside the CPU. Now all the parts are given. So this is nothing but one. This is SP board module and two PCLE card slot one, and then three. This is some power supply where you insert the power supply cord, then memory rises. Four. These are all the memory rises, and then backplane and cover, and six. This is drive backplane, and here seven we place drivers, hard disk, all those things, drivers. Yeah, hard drives here. Then fan modules, eight. This is responsible for cooling the CPU. They have the fan board, ninth is fan board, and then air baffle, 11th is battery, okay, battery for this motherboard, and then processor module, 12 is processor modules, then motherboard, that comes here, this green thing, this is called motherboard, where you insert memory unit, say all those things. Here, these things are needed, extra one, which are needed for running this motherboard without any problem. A motherboard is nothing but, again, our microprocessor, or you call it as a central processing unit. From this, there are many signals going to all those things, they are all interconnected. Okay, and they help in the function of the CPU. The memory unit is mainly used for storing the program, storing the data. Okay, you can call it as a program, but in general, we call it as a data. And CPU, what the function of CPU is, extracts information from the memory and works. That's what we have seen. It is stored. The stored data is extracted by the CPU using the control unit, and the data is processed here, an arithmetic logic unit. So this is otherwise called as primary key or main memory. There are two types. So you can call this main memory as primary key, right? There are broadly there are two types of memories available. One is volatile memory and another one is non-volatile memory. So volatile memory means when the power goes, when the current cut, okay, or any power to the computer goes, everything stored there will be immediately erased. So it is a temporary memory. Example is random access memory, which is nothing but our primary memory or main memory. So you can call a main memory unit as a primary memory or random access memory. So that is where temporary information should be stored. That is why when you type something, okay, and if you don't store, if you don't save it permanently in your secondary disk, which is nothing but when you press the save button, you will have the folder view. Okay, in folder view, you will be storing it in C or D drive. That means you are storing permanently in hard disk. Hard disk is another memory, which we call it as a secondary storage, which is nothing but primary memory, which is a permanent memory. Okay, whereas RAM is a temporary memory. So when you start a system, the information which are stored in the hard disk will be taken and stored in the main memory. And from main memory only, the CPU can access all the data. The CPU is not connected directly with the secondary storage, which is nothing but our hard disk. Okay, so anything has to be first loaded into the main memory, and from main memory only, they can access the data. So that's why they are called volatile memory. As I said, when you switch off the system, when the power goes, whatever you stored in the main memory will be gone. So before switching off, you should save it then and there in your secondary storage backup. Okay, non-volatile memory. Here, the content of this memory will remain even after the power goes. That is what? Permanent. So even if you switch off, it will be there. So next time when you open the system, you will be having the data in your C drive. Now you open it and bring the data from the secondary storage, that is C or D drive, to the main memory, and then you start working there. So some of the permanent memory is, other than this, what I said, hard disk, you have this ROM. ROM is read-only memory. PROM, programmable read-only memory. EEPROM, electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So what is this read-only memory? All these things. They have informations like where the operating system is stored. When during the booting, that is when you switch on the system, from where the operating system also will be stored in the secondary storage only. Okay, as I said, main memory is the one which has connection, and memory is a temporary storage. So always if you see C folder or D folder, you can see in C folder, Windows, there will be a folder called Windows. That the Windows software, that is operating system, is stored. As I said, C and D drive are secondary storage, hard disk. So when you switch on the system, where it is present in the hard disk, that information is stored in this read-only memory. And now what happened? It find that place and start loading the Windows operating system into the main memory in order for the user to work. That is why they have that we call it as a booting address. Okay, so the booting information should be present in read-only memory. So each time there is no need for, you cannot write the booting address. We don't know where actually it is stored in the secondary storage. So this ROM is given by the manufacturer. They will know where that booting address will be present in the secondary storage. So that is why it is called read-only memory. Only the system read. You cannot write. The normal user cannot write. Only the manufacturer, they can write into that using some devices. Okay, then PROM is again, it is one type of ROM where it can be programmable. It can be erased using the ultraviolet rays. That ROM can be erased using ultraviolet, not normal. Why we use the keyboard using delete keys and we delete something. It's not like that. In that memory, the any informations can be deleted using the ultra signals. Okay, EEPROM. EEPROM is erasable. You can erase it and rewrite. EEPROM is electrically erasable ROM. The CPU can work with the information available in main memory only. That's what. See, if you see this picture, the CPU is connected with the memory unit. It is not connected with the hard disk. The hard disk will be separated. That is C and D tray, whatever it is. Okay, it is separate. The memory unit here is nothing but our RAM, random access memory. So the CPU is directly connected with the memory unit, not with the secondary storage. So anything has to be first loaded into the main memory. To access the data from memory, we need two special registers. So in order to access the data from this memory unit, we need mainly two special registers called memory data register, called MDR. And the second one is memory address register. So in the memory address register, the address of the information which we are going to read will be placed. And then once it is placed, the data from the particular location will be placed in the data register. We will see this concept later. Okay, data and program is stored in the main memory. While executing a program, the CPU brings instruction and data from the main memory, performs the task as per the instruction fetched from the memory. So whatever is stated in that particular line, that will be executed. After completion of the operation, then once the operation, respect operation is there, say for example, it has to be stored back, it will be stored back in the memory. The CPU do that using the control unit. So main, what is memory location? Just now I said it is stored in some memory locations and you have to take it. So what is it? Memory locations and address. Now if you see this picture. Let us imagine a main memory like a page. Okay, page. And each line, it has many lines. A page has many lines. A memory is also like this. So each line you can store certain bit of information. And this bit is like 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, a power of 2. Okay, you can store it like that. What is the location of this? Okay, so this is what, say for example, address starts from 000 to this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Here, 10 address lines are there, addresses are there. So if you take this from 00 to next is 1. And the next one is 10, and the next one is 11. Like this, you can uniquely identify this much from this to this one. That is 2 power 10. Here 10 individual digits are there. So 2 power 10, calculated what, that is 1024. 1024 individual lines can be accessed with this. So what do you mean by this address? Like our house. Our house is having an address. Without address, how we can identify a particular person, a particular person's house. So it's equal to that. So this is nothing but address of this particular location. This is a memory. This is a memory location. In order to access data from that, we need a location. So if you give this address in this, whatever I have said, see here, memory address register. I want to read data from this position means, I have to place this address in the MAR, memory address register. Then I have to execute some signal so that the data will be read. Well, which data? This information. This is called data. This will be read in the MDR. It is nothing but memory data register. Okay. So main memory unit, it is the storage unit. And it is very important system in our computer. Imagine if you don't have memory. If I don't remember what I have to do in the morning, what will happen? How to brush, I don't know. How to, the next thing, I don't know. What will happen? I am a vegetable. So a computer is also like that. If it doesn't have main memory, it is nothing. Okay, so a main memory is important system in our computer organization. It consists of a collection of storage locations. It consists of storage locations, each with a unique identifier called an address. That is what? Collection of locations, and each can be uniquely identified with that address. Okay, data is transferred between memory and registers to and fro in terms of group of bits called what? What do you mean by data is transferred between memory and register? Because when I say here, in arithmetic logic unit, we have many registers. From this memory unit, the data will be placed in those registers. Okay, then operations takes place between those registers. So first memory unit, that data will be placed. Okay, so that is what here it is mentioned. Data is transferred between memory and registers, registers which are in central processing unit. Okay, to and fro in terms of group of bits called words. Here, what is words? Like this. So here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. It is nothing but 2 8-byte. Okay. So this is nothing but one word. You can say it as a one word. So data is transferred in group of bits called words. A word can be a group of 8 bits, 16 bits, 32 bits, 64 bits. Here we have given only 16 bits, but more than that also will be there. It can be nowadays more than 128 bits are there. Okay, so if the word is 8 bit, we call it as a byte. The capacity, so 4 bit is nipple. We call 4 bit as nipple and 8 bit as a byte. Then the capacity of a memory is specified by the number of memory location and the amount of information that can be stored in the each location. So what is this capacity? Here if you see this, the address locations are 2 power 10, which means 1024. If I say here, this here, if you say 10 bits are there, okay, so which means 2 power. What is this? It is 1024 individual locations. One location, two location, three location, and so on. Up to this, it is 1024 individual locations. That is there. But if you take number of bits stored is 60. Okay. So what will be the capacity of this? That is 1024 into 16. This will be the memory capacity of this memory. This will be the storage capacity of this memory. So that is what we are seeing this. See here, the capacity of a memory is specified by the number of memory locations. The one which I have explained previously is 1024 individual memory locations. And the amount of information that can be stored in each location. There in each location, we store 16 bits. So 1024 into 16 bits will be the memory capacity of that particular memory. A memory module of capacity, 16 into 4. Suppose it has 16 memory locations and each location can store 4 bits. Means the how you can say it is nothing but 16 into 4. Indicate there are 16 locations in the memory and in each location we can store 4 bit of information. We must know where to store and retrieve information from memory location. This can be done by identifying the respective, how you can do? By identifying the respective memory location. By going to the particular memory location, we can write some data there or replace the data there. So there are mainly two operations with memory, reading and writing. This is to retrieve the data from memory and bring it to the CPU register. Write is to store the data to a memory location from the CPU register. So, as I said, memory locations and address. This is an example. Already we have seen that. Main memory is the important system in our computer organization. It consists of a collection of storage locations, each with a unique identifier called an address. This is called address. Okay. Now data is transferred between memory and register to and fro in terms of group of bits. So if the word is 8 bits, it is referred to as a byte. Now address space. What is address space? This is said to be address space. Now we'll see what is address space. To access a word in memory, it requires an identifier of that location, that is memory location. And this is called as address. The total number of uniquely identifiable location memory in memory is called the address space. So unique identification. So this is called address space. In this case, it is 1024 is the address space. So if you take this, this is only an example for a memory, right? Now, here this is the memory location. This is a memory take. This is a memory before execution. What is the information present in memory? Let us give the name. These are the address 2009, 8, 6, and 5. Now here some data is there. Now MAR, memory address register. In a memory address register, 2005 is given, which is nothing but memory location. And what data to be, this is a memory write, isn't it? So what data to be written on that memory is given here. So after execution, what happens? See, 2005, this will be overwritten. This is after execution. After execution, these two remain same because it is only writing into the memory, not changing this address, any data in this registers. Now memory read. We'll see memory read. Here, what happened before execution and after execution is given. Here, MDR and MAR are there. This is a memory read. Okay, from this memory address, we are supposed to read information and place it in MDR. So, before execution, some data is in MDR. Now, after memory read, it go and search in 2010. Then this 6F is placed in MDR. This is called memory read.